But why do we have math? In other words, why would God allow our brains to see the patterns and symmetry and order in His creation and be able to organize and describe those phenomena using mathematics? Well, it's what we said at the opening. Now let's talk about math in general as a discipline of study. I know it's not everyone's favorite subject, usually because it's taught as a dry, boring set of rules and procedures to memorize, but mathematics is so much more than that. So, what is math then, really? To help answer this question, it's helpful to start at the beginning. Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth," and then God said, "Let there be light." Okay, stop. Do you know how much mathematics is packed into that one word, light? Albert Einstein won the Nobel Prize in 1921 because of his work on the physics of light. His realization that light comes in little packets of energy quanta, or particles we now call photons. But we also know that light behaves like a wave. It's called electromagnetic radiation. And amazingly, everything you'd want to know about electromagnetic radiation, how it behaves and interacts, can be described in just four equations called Maxwell's equations, named after physicist James Clerk Maxwell, who first wrote them down in the 1800s. Behind all of the symbols is some calculus. So usually in school we learn arithmetic and then algebra and then calculus, and there's some of that here. But beyond calculus, there are other branches of mathematics like linear algebra, a really beautiful, ubiquitous kind of math, and some of those related ideas come into Maxwell's equations. But even beyond that, there are more advanced topics with names like topology and differential geometry, and these equations of light can be understood in an even deeper way using these more advanced tools in mathematics. Okay, why am I saying all of this? To overwhelm you? No. The point is simply that math was there at the very beginning of creation. On day one, God spoke light and all of creation into existence, and in that, there is a language that He has graciously given us access to, which enables us to probe some of the wonders of His marvelous creation, and that language is called mathematics. But why do we have math? In other words, why would God allow our brains to see the patterns and symmetry and order in His creation and be able to organize and describe those phenomena using mathematics? Well, it's what we said at the opening. It's for His glory, and it's for the honor and exaltation of Christ. And Scripture makes this clear in a number of places. Psalm 19, verses 1 to 6 immediately come to mind, verses 1 and 2 in particular. "The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the expanse is declaring the work of His hands. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night reveals knowledge." And that crescendos in the New Testament. Think about Hebrews 1, especially verses 1 to 3. "God, having spoken long ago to the fathers in the prophets in many portions and in many ways, in these last days spoke to us in His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, through whom also He made the worlds, who is the radiance of His glory, the exact representation of His nature, and upholds all things by the word of His power, who, having accomplished cleansing for sins, sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high." This portion of Scripture is discussing the superiority of Christ as God's final word. And look at verse 2. Who is Christ? He is the one through whom God made the worlds. What's amazing here is that the Greek word for worlds doesn't just mean the physical material stuff that comprises the matter around us. It also encompasses the things we can't see, the laws of nature and the concepts behind them. The first time I learned this, I was blown away. Concepts? That's precisely mathematics. And it's there again in verse 3 where Christ upholds all things by the word of His power. All things, from the very large to the very small, from the gravitational forces between planets and stars and galaxies to the subatomic forces governing all the atoms and all the matter and all the universe. Not only did Christ create these things, and not only does He continually uphold them, but He also allows us to see just how incredible that is through the universal language of mathematics. We also see this in Colossians 1:17, where Christ is before all things and in Him all things hold together. Verse 16 says that in Christ all things were created, both the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, that's math. And at the end of the verse, all things have been created through Him. And why does He do this? What's the point of having access to math in the first place? For Him. So in Colossians 1, it's for him. In Hebrews 1, it's for him, to put his glory on display. And it's in Romans 1, 2, especially verse 20, where since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, both his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so that people are without excuse. So there's an important warning there too. Now it's true that we can certainly appreciate the beauty of a flower or the vastness of the night sky without knowing any math, but with the knowledge of mathematics, those marvels can be admired on a much deeper level. The analogy I like to give is that it's like watching a masterful movie in a foreign language. Yes, you can appreciate the beautiful cinematography and the powerful acting without understanding the dialogue, but imagine if you understood the language as well. Your capacity to appreciate the story increases so much more, and it's the same with God's creation and the mathematics behind it. But not only can math deepen our appreciation for God's provision and creation, it also enables us to work with that creation. The basis for virtually any invention, discovery, or application in science and technology or engineering is mathematics, from arithmetic and keeping a household budget to basic geometry and setting up irrigation on a farm, all the way to the math of quantum mechanics that describe the silicon atoms in your computer chip. All of this is mathematics, which serves as a basis for obeying God's creation mandate in Genesis 1:28 to subdue the earth. So, there is great nobility in any mathematical endeavor when understood from the perspective of Scripture. And that's true whether you're a professional mathematician, an electrical engineer, and even if you're a young student learning arithmetic for the first time. Okay, admittedly, if you're 5 years old, you may not feel that learning how to add one apple with two apples is noble. If you're in high school, it may not seem that algebra is noble or, frankly, even interesting. Yes, learning mathematics can be frustrating at times. It's not easy. But even then, in what may seem ordinary or mundane, it's incredible that we can go to the creator of the universe, the one who made the worlds and the laws of nature and the concepts behind them, and ask for his help to learn his mathematics so that we can be a faithful steward of the task he has given us to do at that point in time. In other words, learning mathematics and struggling with it can be challenging, yes. But those challenges also come with a wonderful opportunity for fellowship with Christ in prayer. That's part of sanctification and growth in Him. And I want to elaborate on this more in the next video, where we'll speak about math as a vocation. But first, before moving on, I think it's important to pause and have a word of caution. Notice what we've done so far. We started with the Bible and how it equips us as we seek to honor Christ in all things. That foundation then informs us how to think about the discipline of math as a whole, what it is, a language essentially, and why we have it, because it puts God's glory on display and also helps us fulfill his creation mandate in Genesis 1. Now, notice what we did not do. We did not treat the Bible and biblical theology as another academic discipline to consider along with math and science and the humanities and music and so on. A key reason for the Center for Thinking Biblically is to help guard against that slippery slope. So, let me be very explicit about how this applies to mathematics. If biblical theology is viewed, whether intentionally or unintentionally, as just another selection in a buffet of academic offerings, then you end up with math on one hand and the Bible on the other, and a question will arise. Do these things connect? Can they be reconciled? However, if you instead understand the Bible as the foundation for everything, then you don't have that question. You already know the answer. The Bible is the foundation for everything. There's no question to ask. Okay, why make a big deal about this? Because it's not uncommon to drift down this dangerous road, which starts with an improper view of Scripture. Let me give you two examples of what I mean. In mathematics, we might call these counterexamples, or things that illustrate the opposite of what we're interested in. First, sometime in the 1970s, faculty at one Christian college in the US had overruled an attempt to update their academic programs to integrate a biblical worldview. Why? because some faculty members thought it was impossible in their field of study. A math professor in particular believed that, quote, God's revelation in math is silent, end quote, and that there's nothing to say about math from a biblical perspective. Well, hopefully by now you can see the mistakes here. Certainly, God's revelation is not silent in mathematics. It's there shining brilliantly on day one in Genesis 1 when he spoke light into existence. And moreover, the idea that the Bible and mathematics need to be integrated is itself faulty because it implies that they are disconnected. More to the point, it implies the Bible is lacking, that it is deficient, that it cannot handle some areas. But that's not the case. Scripture is sufficient for all things. That's Psalm 19 again, and in the second half, verses 7 to 14 in particular. So it's imperative to have a proper understanding of Scripture. Otherwise, you could be led to inaccurately conclude God has nothing to say about math, which may leave Christian students and teachers in a precarious situation where they may feel compelled to force a connection to make the subject become biblical. But the Bible tells us how to think about math, as we've already seen. Similarly, another word of caution. When studying mathematics, it doesn't take long to notice parallels between qualities of mathematics and attributes of God that we read in Scripture. There's beauty and order and complexity and unity and notions of infinity and so on. Now, it's really important there that I said attributes of God that we read in Scripture. In other words, the Bible informs us about God. Theologians call that special revelation. And what we observe in creation with our eyes or through mathematics or otherwise, those things illustrate the truths we read in Scripture. But these illustrations are necessarily incomplete. They're not the full picture. The full story is only found in Scripture, which means we should be mindful not to flip the roles of the Bible and mathematics or any other discipline. Fascinating aspects of math are not what lead people to repentance in Christ or what inform them about who God is. It's the gospel alone. Romans 1 tells us that the gospel is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, and that gospel is found in Scripture alone. And that kind of clarity is vital when approaching any academic discipline, especially mathematics. So those are a few thoughts I wanted to leave you with. There's lots more we could say, but I hope this at least gives a helpful foundation. What math is, why we have it, and a reminder that Scripture is the foundation for thinking clearly about this discipline of study. And speaking of studying, what about folks who want to learn the language of mathematics? Well, for those who are interested in this discipline because of the way Christ may use it to increase our love for Him and our worship of Him, there is a certain amount of work involved, and that's what we'll cover in the next video, Math as a Vocation.